every time I saw Dana, Dana was talking about family and how he loved his family, how he loves his family, and how he wants family to be together, how he feels like we haven't been together since grandma passed, and he wants family to come together. And that's how I describe him, as just a man who loves his family.
I just wanna make it to heaven. Just wanna make it in. Oh, I just wanna cross that river. My Lord, I wanna be free from sin.
Out of this world, the soul of our deceased brother, we therefore commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, looking for the general resurrection and the last day and the life of the world to come, through our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose second coming in his glorious majesty to judge the world, the earth, and the sea, shall give up the dead.
Tell them how much you love me, baby.
Too much.
How much is too much?
Not enough.
How much is too much?
Not enough.
Not enough. Tell them hi.
Hi.
Say bye.
Bye.
Remember, it's the little things that mean so much. I am who. Check my program out, and I guarantee you, you will see a lot more. Remember, I'm no professional. I'm no expert. I'm not even certified. I'm just plain old who. And if you don't know who, you better ask somebody. Saturday and Sunday at 6 p.m., Tuesday and Thursdays at 8:30 a.m. on Channel 2, the number one channel on cable. Talk to you later. I'm gone. Peace.
Dana was love, and Dana believed in living life. He believed in living life to the fullest. Dana lived a lifetime, even in his short time being here. He lived a lifetime. So I would say Dana was love and Dana was life.
Dana was bigger than life. I looked up to Dana. Dana was my hero.
He's what life should be. He's the epitome of what life is. And his love comes natural to him. He is Dana.
I want to say that every time I see Dana, or every time I saw Dana, it was always love. It was always, I love you, cuz. Hey, cuz, how you doing? You look good. We like, hey, cuz, you look good. You know, he always told me he loved me. Like, always. Every single time I talked to him, it doesn't matter if I saw him in the street, he always makes sure he told me he loved me before we. You can come on in.
I know you may be in pain right now, but it'll come back. And you'll be laughing again real soon, because that's what they would want you to do. I love you, Mom. I love my father. I love my brothers and sisters. I love 310 East 17th Street. I love my friends. I love my cousins, my uncles and nieces, my aunts. I love you. And don't think I'm talking about you. I'm looking at myself. I love myself. You thought I was talking to you, didn't you? Well, I'm talking to me. I love you. Yes, I'm looking at myself, talking to myself. Because nobody can love me the way I love me. So, if you happen to be out there, love yourself first. and you will see there's nothing like that. Because I know what I'm talking about. I love myself. And it's a lot of love I got for myself. So take care. Peace. Enjoy your Saturday and get it in. Get it in while you can, while your kids are asleep. Take care. Talk to you later. I love you, Nadine. Bye.
My name is Sabrina. When I was a teenager, Dana came to visit me in Meadville, PA. He met me at McDonald's, which is downtown in Meadville. I got to the front door of McDonald's and Dana was outside waiting for me, but he was standing next to this pretty blue motorcycle. And so he was like, "Hey, sis." And I said, "Hey." And he said, "What are you doing?" And I said, "Nothing, but this is a nice bike." He said, "You like it?" I said, "Yeah, I like it." He was like, "You want to go for a ride on it?" And I go, "Yeah, I would love to go for a ride on it." So I got on the bike. The bike wasn't Dana's. So I realized, and I said, "This isn't your bike, is it?" He was like, "No." He started cracking up. So I jumped off the bike. So there's my funny story about Dana. Big sense of humor.
There was one evening I was out at a club, and it was a couple of girls there that were, kind of nagging me to, they wanted to fight. And I was with a couple of people, but I said, I'm not going to do that with these people. She had too many friends with her. I told her, "Hold on for a minute, let me call my brother, and then, you know, we could do this." So out of all my brothers, I called Dana and waited for Dana to come. And when Dana got there, he told me to get in the car. He was not letting me fight. And I said, "If I don't fight, they're gonna think that I'm scared of them." And he was like, "I'm not letting you fight, so get in the car. I don't care what they think." And as much as I begged him to let me go, he would not let me get out of the car to go and fight. He stood there, made me get in my car, and watched me drive home. I was so mad at him about that for a couple of years, but I understand why he did it. So that'd be probably one of the many fondest memories I have of him. When I had gotten pregnant, Dana was living with me, and he would come home in the middle of the night and make sure that I had eaten, always made sure if I needed anything. When my daughter was born, he was the first one to the hospital to see her, to bring her her first stuffed animal. When my son came along, he was there too. He lived with me then too. He always played with them. If I had some place to go, he always watched them. He was just that type of person.
Dana would just get all up in our faces with the camera, even though, like, I didn't really like to be in the camera, but he would just always find a way to just get in my face and just crack a smile out of me.
I was gonna say the same thing. That's all he did was have that camera in your face, no matter what.
I got a lot of memories of Dana. A lot of memories. But I'll put them all in one bunch. Every time I seen Dana, I always heard, "Hey, Uncle Frank." And we would always get into a deep conversation about something. And that's what I'm gonna miss about him. Every time I see him, I always heard them words, "Hey, Uncle Frank."
Not too many people notice, but Dana was my first love. Because when I was 10 years old, maybe 10 or 11, Dana and my brother lived across the street. So I wrote Dana a letter, and it was one of those, "Will you be my boyfriend, yes or no?" Because Dana was one of the finest, is one of my finest nephews ever, and he knew that. And Dana, to this day, Dana still has that letter. I told Nadine if she could find it, I want it. Because Dana would pull it out every so often, every so many years. And he'd be like, "Auntie, you thought I didn't still have this?" So Dana was my first love. And then even when I graduated, I wrote something on the back of a picture of me, you know, letting Dana know that I still loved him. Dana was my heart, you know, and he's gonna always be my heart. I just can't wrap my mind around. I can't wrap my mind around this because I love him. I love Dana so much. Always in my inbox, you know.
always in my inbox telling me how much he loved me, or if he saw me just in passing, hey, I just passed you. You didn't see me, you know? Tell me you love me, you know? He would make you tell me you love me. And then I have like, I'm so happy I have like a voice message from Dana, and he said, hey, Aunt Shelly, I don't know what the message was before, but he said, hey, Aunt Shelly, I'm so happy to hear that. And I probably told him that I love him. And then he had to text, he had to say something back, and it was just a voice message. And he said, hey, nigga, what's up? Dana, it's my heart. Oh my gosh, I love that man so much. I love him so much.
Every memory I have with Dana has always been on a good note. But the most recent would be, I saw him in October at Walmart, up at Walmart on Elm Street. It's really odd. At one point, I was walking and him and Dani was driving away. They were driving in and I was walking away, but he literally stopped the car, got out the car, and he came and he gave me a hug. Hey, cuz, how you doing? Dani and I spoke and so on, and that was that. So literally like about 3 or 4 days later, same thing happened, but opposite positions. Him and Dani are walking in and I'm driving. So of course I'm following Dana because like I said, he just makes me such a better person and just wants to do well in life just overall. I stop my vehicle and traffic's behind me. I get out the car and I'm like, Dana, and we hug each other. I'm like, hey, Dani, you know, 3 o'clock actually, because he called his daughter 3 o'clock because he picked her up at 3 o'clock. So he called her that for years. So that's honestly what I would still call her today. So I'm like, hey, Dana, and 3 o'clock. And so that's how I would summarize him, seeing my memories with him. Just every time I would see him, the sun just seemed so much brighter. The sky just seemed so much bluer.
Well, the memory that I have of him is just taking care of his children. Dana was 41 years old when he had his first child. And he was the proudest father. And then Dani came along. He had Dana, and then Dani came along, and he was just a proud dad. And it wasn't a problem for him to take care of his responsibility and to raise his children. That was just him. His children, you was not far from him ever, going places. And if Dana did go out, happened to go out, he always said that I had to get back to my children. So just of him taking care of his children, being that great father.
Growing up, Dana was like a father to me. He was my father growing up. He told me the right things to do in life. Everything I ever wanted, he knew what to tell me. My memory of Dana was about a month ago, somewhere around there. He told me he loved me. He's never once in my life told me he loved me, but I always knew he did. He stopped me in the middle of the street. We was side by side with our cars. I took my window down and he said, JJ, you know what? I said, what's up? He said, I love you. Caught me off guard. Never heard them words come out of his mouth ever. So I was shocked and I couldn't say nothing back. He said, I never told you that, but I want to tell you that right now. I love you. And I said, thank you, Dana. And we drove off. That's the last time I seen him.
I just found out that through my oldest son, just today, there was times that I was missing, you know, MIA with my family, my kids, and had no contact with them. My youngest son just told me that Dan used to come and get his hair cut. He used to take care of him, show him what love is. All my children, actually, and I have 6 children. I got 4 daughters and 2 sons, and they all know Dana. And they all think he's the same way I do. He's love. And that's the best memory I have of what I got today from my oldest son. I didn't know that, but yeah, he's been like a father to my children.
So, it's a lot of the memories. How long do I have? Okay. So, it's a lot of the memories. I could talk about, now for one, everybody knows that Dana is known for having his camera around, always recording stuff, okay? So I could say that my favorite memory would be when I was like maybe about one, 2 years old in the driveway on 4th Street, and he had me outside in the garage, in the driveway, saying my ABCs. I can talk about, you know, the time where he made everybody in the house wake up, and we had to, when we were living on West 8th Street, and across the street from us was like this vacant parking lot with like a big brick building on the side. So he had all of us, like, it was like 2-3 in the morning, do like these little like funny walks and stuff across the camera, almost like we were like trying to hide. It was something like things you would see at night type stuff. It was cool. Or I can talk about the time when, again, I lived on West 8th Street, and me and my brother and David Harden, and we were neighbors, and we were in the backyard being fast, and caught us. But what I am going to talk about is it was on Thanksgiving. I want to say I was maybe about like 9-10 years old, about 9 years old. And it was me, my brother, my cousins, Justin, Adresia, Talisha, Vanessa, even Ola. We were upstairs drawing on these paper plates. And I remember snatching a plate from my little brother. And like just really just being mean to him. And then my brother started to cry and started to say he was gonna go tell my mom and stuff. So I'm sitting there like, no, please don't, please don't. And then out of nowhere, my Uncle Dana just opened the door with the camera. He's like, uh-huh. And my face was just like, oh, I just knew I was going to get my tail whooped that day. So, but I mean, it's hard to narrow it down to just one memory, because all he was just, he was such a great man. You couldn't help but to create memories around him. Even when you think he's not there, he was there every time. So, but yeah.
So my memory is when I talked about the burgundy Honda. He used to have this burgundy Honda, and he used to come out on the terrace because I think he liked my godmother. I'm almost certain he did, but I ain't gonna say no names. And Dana used to take me for ice cream and everything, trying to really like get to know her. And since I was always, you know, under my godmom, he was like, I want to be there too, you know. But he was my cousin automatically, and that's my memory I have with that burgundy Honda. He used to come and take me for rides in the burgundy Honda, everything. What about you, Damon?
I just remember his energy. I just, when he used to always run. Wouldn't drive his car. He said, where your car at? I don't need to drive my car all the time. Sometimes we can walk. We keep getting in that car and stuff. He's always, you ain't got to drive it all the time. Walk sometimes. You know, I remember that.
Well, this is one of my best memories of what he sent me. Hold on.
Oh, look at that.
One of my best memories of my dad, and he was riding down parade,
oh, yeah,
14th parade. Of parade, and he seen my dad walking.
Wow.
And showed me this video so of him.
Yes, that is.
Wow, that is
that
so
is a
nice
blessing, and I love my cousin.
You hear me, Albert? J-Man, I'm building up the motivation. Hey, Albert, seriously, I do love you. I love my cousin. Okay, but here's the motivation, y'all.
Hey, Nia, I seen your text. As soon as I pick up the phone, I get ready to tell you something, it cut off for me. But how you doing, cuz? And I wish I could have caught it. I hope you got back. I hope you're back on there. I hope you're back. But I love you, and I wanted to tell you that while you was on the air, but I must have missed it. But look here, if you're still out there, I appreciate you.
Hold on.
And
you carry that to the court too.
I'll tell you one thing. His catalog is worth a lot of money, because yes, if I had to bid on it, I would bid for his catalog. He has everybody's memories when it was little. You know, my brothers. You know, he sent me videos of my brothers and them talking like they talking to me, and it's just incredible.
But the reason why I'm here is I forgot it's my cousin's birthday too. Pumpkin. Happy birthday to you, Cynthia's daughter. Hello, Cynthia. Uncle John's daughter. Hello.
birthday, little girl. Yeah, it's your birthday. I just want to say happy birthday to you. Yes, happy birthday, pumpkin. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
You gotta get it in, even though she ain't a little girl. Happy birthday, young lady. And I just want to tell you that I love you too. I love you this much. So, Punky, I hope you have a good day. I really do. And we all know you deserve it because you're Cynthia's daughter, because you're John's daughter, because you're my cousin, because you've just always been so cool.
Always working. Like, he was always working, whether it was, you know, the fitness show that he did on cable access, or working for the city. I was a city councilman for 13 years, so it was around the time, I came on council a little bit, around the time he got hired at the city, doing the work he was doing, and we'd always see each other, he was always moving, and, you know, I always crack the joke, man, you know, him riding in that little yellow truck, pickup truck for the city, running errands, doing projects, and so just always on the move. He's a great example in that way, a great model in that. You know, again, it was really just that seeing him in that truck, you know, was like the funniest thing all the time. He was always in it, always moving. We lived around the corner from each other, and I'd go home for a quick break or run in the middle of the day to do something at the house, and then I'd see that truck come around the corner. I'm like, oh man, you on the clock? Are you on the clock in the city vehicle going to your house? And he's like, don't worry about that, sir. Don't worry about that. And he never got like a joke. He didn't really laugh, but he was just like, don't worry about that. I got this, you know. So there's a lot of little nuances that are funny and that are I guess uniquely Dana. But always at the end of the day, he was always real smooth, real gracious, very respectful. And I think a lot of us could emulate, if we were to emulate some of those characteristics, we'd be doing well in life.
The only memory, you know, he's always had a camera. He's always had a video camera. You know, he's always in your face with it, asking you who's your family, where you come from, this and that. You know, he was that type of guy, you know. He wanted to know family history, you know, where you came from and everything.
My name is Ola White. I am Dana's baby sister. I gotta kind of put a little twist on that because I'm not actually his baby sister.
Sure you are.
Yes, that's one thing that I wanted to say is that he never made me feel any different. But let me explain. His mother and father, Tommie and Adresia Stovall, took me in from Adresia, which is Tommie's wife's sister's sister. I'm her daughter. But they took me in and they took care of me and they raised me as their own. Dana never made me feel like I belonged anywhere else. I have the fondest memories of being 3, 4, 5, of being on his shoulders and having the coolest kicks on. He always made sure that every time I seen him, he took me to the store, to the mall, and we would buy new shoes. Always. Never, not one time. Can I remember me being a baby? I'm talking 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Every time I seen him, we went to the store and we would buy new kicks. But the thing that made, he was my brother of no other, just like the other siblings. But he made sure that I felt like I was a Stovall. I didn't come from anywhere else. you're my sister, you're my baby sister, and that's all that I know. I remember the first time that I back talked to my mom. And she called him. And he said, "You're my little sister. Why are you talking back to our mother like that?" He said, "She took you in. She took care of you. And we've loved you no other way, but just loved you." And I said, "I'm sorry. You know, it won't happen again." And it never did. Because my mother had got sick. And I was mainly the one there taking care of her. But he called every day to make sure that I was okay. I just want to say that Dana was a good man. He was always happy. He was always a memory keeper. And I'm going to miss that.
Oh, goodness. A lot of memories. Just grandma, just thinking about grandma, because Dana loved our grandma. And whenever Dana would come with that camera, grandma would go try to run and hide. She would try to do it sneaky, and Dana would be talking to her, and then she'd be, or she would go in the background. She would always try to run and hide, but he would always come behind her and try to get her to answer questions because he knew it was important to have that history. So that's to me, that's a very, very important memory, very close memory, his relationship with grandma, because he loved her. He loved her so much, and he wanted to make sure that he captured every moment that he could with her on video so that we had grandma to remember, even if she wasn't around, because she did pass on in 2008, but at least we had grandma on video as of Dana. Dana made sure that happened.
Got that party stuff around there. Huh? Oh, I'm not
have kids till he was older in age. Till I think he had Dana when he was, I think he was 40 or 41, but that was the proudest moment of his life. He was so ecstatic to be having his first child, and then it was a boy. He was just beside himself. He kept his, both of them. When his daughter came, he was even just as happy. He loved his kids more than anything. Dana wouldn't go anywhere unless his kids could go with them. His day was not complete unless his kids was with him. He called his daughter Delicious, and she was his 3 o'clock. He picked her up every day from school at 3 o'clock. Delicious at 3 o'clock. And Dana, there's nothing that he wouldn't do for his son either. That was truly his junior.
Danny and Daniel, you were his life, you were his world. When he had you, it was all about you. He stopped what he was doing, and he just like totally raised you from babies on up. I mean, the love he had for you is like no other, you know. So just be encouraged, and you know, when you're going through something, just think about your dad and everything he taught you guys, and you'll be okay. And just know that your family, we all love you. We might not see you that much, but we love you and we're here for you. And I'm not just saying that. I'm just a phone call away. Nadine has my number. If you need me for anything, and I mean that, if you need me, I'm here. I'm here.
Well, first of all, I just want to tell you, Dani and Dana, that I love y'all very, very much. You know, I'm here for you. Anything that you need, you know, I'm here. If I got it, it's yours. One thing that I would say is live life. Dana lived, Dyniece said it best today, Dana lived for the moment. And I would just tell you, live life. Your dad would want y'all to live life.
Words of encouragement to Dani and Dana is remember your father, remember who you are, and remember that we as a family love you.
I know that it's a lot of things that don't make sense right now, but stay strong. You are always loved and he is always here with you. He gave you guys all the tools to keep on going. When time gets hard, just hear his voice because he's always there. He's always there. He's in your hearts. He's in your minds. He's in your souls. He's always going to be with you. And we all love you. And it does get easier.
I love you and I appreciate everything that you've done for our family, even helping to be the glue to this family. You know, everyone that we've talked to has said how much they loved you and how much you loved and how hard you love this family. So I thank you for that. I thank you for being a great representation of the Stovall Nation.
I love you so much from the bottom of my heart.
Who do I love? Dana who?
Uncle, I love you. I love you, and I know that you're better, and I know that God needed you more than we needed you here. But your legacy is going to live on through us.
I don't even want to get into last words. I can't function on last words. I cannot.
I'm going to say something good to you, Dana. And they have always been my words. You're one of the best souls this world can ever offer. I have always told him that.
Dana, we love you. And we're going to miss the tangible part of you, as far as us being able to lay our hands on you, to see your smile, to kiss you, to hug you. But it's all right, because I know that God has a greater plan for you. You will always be here in spirit, and all of us, we will see you again. And you have been an angel on this earth, and we've learned from you to enjoy each moment as it comes about, and just enjoy life every moment. Just be thankful for something. All of us need to be. It's just a sense of gratitude for life, and to appreciate life as you did. And we thank you for being that example for us. And we know that you are love, and we know that you were God sent. And we thank God for allowing us to have this time with you. But he had a greater purpose for you, like I'm sure you know. But we love you and we miss you, and we will see you again.
I'll see you when I get there. I love you.
I'm upset with you because there was some unfinished business. But I have to acknowledge that if you went home like you did, you felt it was finished. So I feel like it was finished. And I love you.
I love you, Dana. I miss you.
Daddy was the best big brother I could ever ask for. He taught me so much. Showed me so much love. Just a good brother, and I love him.
Thank you for being a model of persistence, you know, teaching us about fitness, teaching us about being our best selves. Didn't say a whole lot all the time, but modeled a whole lot more than you said. And so thank you for that. And again, many of us could learn some lessons from his example. And so thank you for the example.
I love you, cousin. I love you. And I just want you to know I love you. I love you. And thank you. Thank you for the videos. Thank you for the encouragement. Thank you for putting family first. I love you. I love you, cousin. I love you.
I want the overall family to at least get together once a year, that we all get together once a year, just so we can honor his memory and just so we can tell each other we love each other. Because this here isn't forever, but we know where he is forever. And we want to make sure that we honor his legacy while we're here and for eternity.
I love you, cousin.